So in the book of Galatians, we see a story that some people who had believed in Jesus, now again they're returning back to what they were living in, they're used to, which is the old system of the law that they're living in. And Paul says, why are you doing this? Why are you returning to that system? And then he brings an example and he says, you who desire to be under the law, don't you hear the law that Abraham had two sons? So he immediately brings a picture in just because he wants to explain something. And then he says, these two sons, which we know were Isaac and Ishmael, he says, these are symbolic. And one is basically from Sarai, one is from Hagar. And he says, Hagar is Mount Sinai, which corresponds to Jerusalem, which is present, which is now, which is the physical Jerusalem that is in a place. And then, so he immediately basically relates this to a covenant. And he says, these two sons are the two covenants. And then he says, one is from Mount Sinai, from Hagar. And then he says, that's the old covenant, and that corresponds to the old Jerusalem, which is the physical Jerusalem. So then he says that we are from Jerusalem, which is from above. And he says, this is another covenant. And then he says, this is the new covenant. The first is based on flesh. The second is based on a promise. The first was like, as basically Ishmael was, which was a basically child of the flesh, out of the will of flesh he came. But the second is Isaac, which is based on the promise which God gave Abraham. So then he goes on to say, now we, like Isaac, are children of promise. And he says, we are from Jerusalem, which is from above, which is the mother of us all. So Jerusalem above basically is compared to Jerusalem, which is now, at that time, which is the physical Jerusalem. So then he says, one covenant is the relating or corresponding to the old Jerusalem, one is the new Jerusalem. So now we all also know that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and chapter 11, we read that Paul says, the cup of blessing which we bless is the communion of the blood of Jesus. Jesus himself in Matthew 26, verse 27 to 29, he says, drink of this. This is the blood of the New Testament or covenant. So now, that blood has become a testament for us, that or covenant, and that covenant corresponds to Jerusalem, which is from above. So this is called now a heavenly Jerusalem, or holy Jerusalem, or the new Jerusalem. We can see these terms all over the Bible. So now we see a picture of a city which was in the old, which was the old Jerusalem, and now we have a new city which is part of the a group of people that are basically based on the promise of God. Who are these? These are the ones that actually believed in the name of Jesus, and now they have this city. But we want to see what this city actually is, and just to go into understanding what are the benefits of this city. And because the reason is, there are so many verses in the Bible that because they have been seen or understood as something for the future, when everybody dies or when Jesus comes back, then because of that, sometimes we don't live in the full benefit of what is available right now. One is this understanding of New Jerusalem. And we see this understanding of city right from the old, from the book of Genesis, chapter 11, all to the book of Revelation, chapter 21 and 22, that this city is repeatedly talked about. And we can see the importance of this city. Maybe we can go actually to Genesis.
Sure.
11. So, if we look at verse 4 in Genesis, so here we have a group of people gathered together, and this is what they say: come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens, So a city whose top is in the heaven. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, indeed the people are one, and they all have one language. And this is what they begin to do. Now, nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they ceased building the city. So they started to build the city, and God came and stopped that process. But now, why did this happen? Why did God stop building this city?
Mm-hmm. And you know, like, also the first place that we see that mankind started building this city, it was Cain. Mm-hmm. That after he killed his brother Abel, then Cain goes from the presence of the Lord, mm-hmm. and then he goes and he makes a city, and he calls the city after the name of his son. Mm-hmm. And from that time we see that over and over, you know, in Genesis it says that people started a city. So when it gets to this story here, that it says, let us build us a city. Let us build us a city, mm-hmm. that we can. And they say why they want to do it, because they want to reach out to heaven and make a name for themselves. So now, you know, a friend of mine was saying, so this is not a bad thing. So why did God went and destroy the whole thing? Because that is the whole point. Because mankind was not supposed to build their own way to heaven. So we were supposed to receive God's way into heaven. And when mankind started building, okay, let us build a city, a tower that reaches out to heaven, to God, that means that shows the intention that we want to find a way to get there. But Jesus came and said, mm-hmm. that I am the way to the Father, and no one can get to the Father. No one can get into the heaven, mm-hmm. except through me. So then, and even, you know, God does not accept the sacrifices that the mm-hmm. human beings bringing. Mm-hmm. Our ways, the way that we are doing it. And when we get to Jeremiah, in Jeremiah it says that my people have committed, they have committed two sins. Mm-hmm. They have forsaken me, mm-hmm. the fountain of the living water, and they have made for themselves cisterns, the broken cisterns that cannot hold water. Mm-hmm. So the people that that they start making for themselves, mm-hmm. things, this is considered sin in the sight of God, because God wants us to come to his way, to come to his, the living fountain, the living water, right. Because the things that we're going to make for ourselves with our hands, mm-hmm. are called idol, and you know, and they're like a broken cisterns, but God wants us to come to the fountain, mm-hmm. of the living water.
Yeah, exactly. So as you said, they were trying to reach out to heaven, so they want to see, they want to build a city, or make themselves a city that whose top is into heaven. But we see this picture now in the other way, that God's intention was to actually bring down a city from heaven on earth, because God's intention from the beginning was for people, mm-hmm. to live on earth and dominate on earth and, mm-hmm. Bring peace and basically kind of have authority over all the creation, and bring that liberty that God intends. And now he says he wants to do this through sons of God, those who believe in the name of, mm-hmm. Jesus, those who are called the body of Christ or the church of God. So now this city actually was later on in the story of the Jews, when they started basically becoming the people of God and they received the covenant, they actually had a city, and that city was called Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. So now this goes on, and this story of cities keep repeating, but then the thing is, even though there is a city built on earth, but still people are not living in the benefits of what God intends for them. So now Jesus comes into picture later on in Matthew 5, and he comes and he says, you are the light of the world, you are the city set on a hill. or a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. So now he says there is a city and there is a hill. So this city that he mentions, he says, you are that city. So it's not a place, it's actually people that are this city. So he says this city is on a hill. What city and what hill? Jerusalem was on a hill or on a mountain.
Mm-hmm.
So now he comes and he says that to the woman at the wall in John chapter 4, mm-hmm. that she comes and after a long conversation with mm-hmm. Jesus, she says that you Jews say, or our ancestors say that we have to worship on the mountain, but you Jews say Jerusalem is the place that we have to mm-hmm. worship. So she brings in immediately the mountain and the city
mm-hmm.
again. And she's confused. She says, where? I mean, she's asking a question. And Jesus says, believe me, woman, the time is coming and now is here, which the true worshipers will worship God in spirit and truth, not on a physical mountain and not in a physical city, but actually on a spiritual mountain and a spiritual city. What is that? The Mount Zion, and then the city is the New Jerusalem, which is called the spirit and truth. You will worship God in spirit and truth. So the Mount Zion is the spirit of God.
Yeah.
And the city is actually, or Jerusalem, is the city of truth. We can even see this in Zechariah 8, but it's the city of truth. So now, what is this city of truth?
Mm-hmm.
We know that Jesus says, I am the truth. And then he says, whoever follows him will actually walk in the truth, or 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John, over and over. John says that, I rejoice to see my children walk in truth. So now, if we put all this together, we come to a place that we see the picture of New Jerusalem.
And also in Hebrews chapter 11, it's talking about Abraham and those people that they looked
mm-hmm.
for the city that their founder, the founder is not a man,
mm-hmm.
it's God, right?
Yeah.
And if we read the Hebrews 11 verse 16, they desired a better that is a heavenly.
Yeah.
So it's talking about the city, because the verse before that, therefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he,
mm-hmm.
God, has prepared a city for them. So it says those people of faith, they were looking for a city that God has prepared for them. But in Genesis 11, people wanted to make the city for themselves. We want to make us a city and apart from God. And now it says God is not ashamed to be called their God to Abraham and those that are waiting for the city that the founder and the builder actually it's God himself. So basically, and as we go on and we see that city, it's important.
Yeah.
Because even when God took Israelites out of Egypt and brought them to wilderness and take them to promised land, then he says, you know, oh, you, the, he wanted to make the city mm-hmm. for them. So the city that has a king,
mm-hmm.
and this city that, you know, it's a city of God. And when we get to book of Revelation, and in the last two chapters, Revelation 21 mm-hmm. is talking about the city that is coming down
yeah.
out of heaven. And considering this, that Jesus said, you are the city
mm-hmm.
on a hill. And we know that, as Masood explained, that hill, the mountain, right now is a spiritual mountain,
yeah.
which is Mount Zion.
Yeah.
And the city is this Jerusalem from above, which is the heavenly
yeah.
Jerusalem.
Yeah, exactly. So even going back to that story of Abraham and this city that he says, because chapter 11 of Hebrews is all about the people that live by faith. And he says, even though they inherited so many things, so many promises, but one thing they lacked, and they always knew that actually they haven't received that, and they died without receiving that one promise. And he says, that one thing is, like Abraham, he says, when God called him out of his own city,
mm-hmm.
He actually followed God without knowing where he's going. So even when he went to a land that actually was promised to him,
mm-hmm.
he realized that he's a foreigner in that land. So he's not actually the promise that God had given him, the fullness of it, was not that actually he would inherit a physical land.
Yeah.
But he says, while they were on earth, they declared or expressed plainly that they are waiting for another city. And he says, and because of that, God is not ashamed to be called their God,
yeah.
For he has prepared a city for them. So what is this city, as you said? So again, this is something related to heaven, a city coming down from heaven. So if you go to Revelation 21, he says, then I saw, verse 2, then I saw the holy city, mm-hmm. New Jerusalem. So the holy city, which is the New Jerusalem, coming down, so it's coming down, out of heaven.
Yes.
So it's heavenly. It's heavenly Jerusalem, it's New Jerusalem, from God, prepared. So it's prepared. God mm-hmm. has prepared for them a city. So it's prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So now we know that actually this city is also a bride.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to see that these are signs that God is actually using to talk to us. How can a city be married?
To Christ or to...
Right?
Yeah.
So, and who is this city married to? Well, later on it says that actually the bridegroom is the Lamb. So the husband is the Lamb. Who is the Lamb? The crucified Christ. And how did this happen? When Jesus was crucified
mm-hmm.
and then he rose again, he became
mm-hmm.
the resurrected Christ. So now we are married to the resurrected Christ.
Yeah.
And the bride of Christ is his church, the people.
Yes.
Which is also called the people of the new covenant,
mm-hmm.
which according to Galatians 4 is actually the heavenly Jerusalem, the
mm-hmm.
Jerusalem which is above. So this language, let me just say this, because in one place he says the new Jerusalem is our mother. In Revelation he says it's the bride
yes.
of Christ. So how can one city be bride
mm-hmm.
and basically the mother at the same time? Only in spirit, because it's a spiritual understanding that God uses
yeah.
to, because when we say marriage, in the first thing that actually comes to people's mind in the natural is a certain
mm-hmm.
lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
But marriage simply means unity. So now when we are married to the resurrected Christ, it means we are one with him.
Yeah.
So now the bride is the body of Christ, and the Lamb is Christ himself. So now the body of Christ is married to Christ himself, and through that they have become one body. So this is the understanding of basically a unity between Christ and his church.
So the city
yeah.
is the bride, is the
exactly.
body of Christ. So in Hebrews, it says, now you have come
mm-hmm.
to the Mount Zion.
Exactly.
To the city of the living God. So you have come.
Yeah.
The moment we come to Jesus
mm-hmm.
and we have come to the Mount Zion,
yeah.
to the city of the living God. And then it goes on and it says, what is really amazing for me, it starts talking about Jesus in Hebrews 12. It says, now you have come, verse 22, to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem.
Yeah.
So Mount Zion, city,
yeah.
heavenly Jerusalem.
Exactly.
So, and then we know that heavenly Jerusalem, it's a Jerusalem that comes from heaven, come out. So it's a heavenly Jerusalem. In Revelation, it says this heavenly Jerusalem is like a bride, is the bride, right?
Yeah.
So to, and then in Hebrews says, to innumerable company of angels, to general assembly and church
yeah.
of the firstborn.
These are all the same.
They are all of them the same, right? So we know the church is the body of
yeah.
Christ, and now it's a bride. And now we understand it's the heavenly Jerusalem
yeah.
that comes out from God. It's not the city that we make for ourselves. It's not a physical city that we make with our hands.
Yeah.
It's a city that comes out from heaven. So registered in heaven. So we see that keeps repeating heaven,
yeah.
heavenly things, right?
Yeah.
Verse 23, end of the verse. to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men make perfect. So a spirit comes to the picture. So it's a spiritual thing to Jesus.
Yeah.
The mediator of the new covenant and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better than the blood of Abel. So we have come to this. We have come to the new city, right?
Yeah.
So now...
it's not a place that we are going to go. It's something that we have already
And it's come. Not a physical place
it's
that
not.
Jesus is coming. Well, it is the heavenly Jerusalem needs to come out of heaven from the spirit as we read here, be adorned and prepared for her husband to come for the marriage, and they become one and get together. So basically, so this Jerusalem above is our mother. The Jerusalem above is where it's from heaven. It's not the earthly city or the tangible, because in Hebrews, right before that, a couple of verses before that, in Hebrews 12, it says, just a couple of verses, it says, you have not, verse 18, chapter 12, you have not come to the mountain that may be touched and that burned with fire.
Yeah, so it's not touchable.
So it's not a material. So Amplified says, you have not come, as did the Israelites in the wilderness, to a material mountain that can be touched. The Israelites in wilderness, they were looking for material things.
Yeah.
Things that can be touched. And they went to the Mount Sinai, and it says it was trembling, it was darkness, it was fearing, that even Moses said, I am exceedingly afraid.
Amen.
But he says, you haven't come to this mountain that can be touched, that can be fearful and trembling, but to the Mount Zion, which is the city which is heavenly.
Now the thing is, those people actually under that old, with the old system, they had visible glory, which was on earth. So they were on earth seeing the pillar of cloud, the fire, all of that. And even Moses himself, basically, the glory of God was in his face. And 2 Corinthians 3 says, how much more now, actually, because our glory is not passing away, a glory that remains. We should have much more glory. So we're not saying, we're not reducing anything from the new. Actually, we want to put it in the right place and saying the new is something that we have to be our place. So now Romans 7:4 says, now my brethren, you also, because you were previously married to the law, the first covenant. So that's how the unity had happened there. They were under the law. So true that they were married to the law. He says, now you are dead to the law, to be married to another, which is raised from the dead. So we are married to the Christ, who? The bride of Christ. We, as the church of God. So now he says, in Galatians 4, he says, now this city, this Jerusalem, is the mother of us all. And then he's at the same time, it says that, he quotes a scripture from Isaiah 54, says, rejoice, O barren, you who do not bear, break forth and shout, for you who are not in labor, for the desolate has many more children than she who has a husband. Let's see what he's talking about. We have to go to Isaiah 54 and see what it says. So Isaiah 54 starts same way. Sing, O barren, you who have not born, break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not labored with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman, says the Lord. Who is the married woman? The first covenant. God divorces the first woman, which is the first covenant.
Yes.
In Hebrews chapter end of chapter 8, he says, when he says a new covenant I make, he has made the first obsolete. Now, what is obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. So that basically wife is out. Now we have a new one, which is the bride of Christ. And then in the same chapter, 54, verse 4 says, do not fear, for you will not be ashamed, neither be disgraced, for you will not be put to shame, for you will forget the shame of your youth and will not remember the reproach of your widowhood anymore, for your maker is your husband. Who? God himself. The Lord of hosts is his name. And your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel.
Yes, that's right.
He is called the God of the whole earth. He's making a unity mm-hmm. between heaven and earth.
Mm-hmm.
The God of hosts, the God of heaven, comes to become the God of the whole earth. And he's making a unity between heaven and earth. This is what Jesus said, pray. That your kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven.
That's
so
right.
So if we see, if understand that we are the city,
mm-hmm.
then if, when we go back to the Old Testament, or not the Old mm-hmm. Testament, the books that are the books before Jesus
yes,
came.
Yes, that's right.
Because Old Testament means Old Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
It's different. So now if we look at those, especially Book of Psalms
yeah.
and Isaiah, I mean, there are so many prophecies about the Church of Christ that has been considered for another group, which
mm-hmm.
is the physical Jerusalem, which is kind of being postponed at the same time because they
mm-hmm.
say until Jerusalem is saved,
mm-hmm.
nobody can have those promises.
Mm-hmm.
But Isaiah 60, Isaiah 61, Isaiah 62, I mean so many of them. If we read them, we understand what are the glories that now is about to be revealed in the church.
Amen.